Are you an open person or a closed person on the whole, then?
I think I'm open when I need to be open, which is when I'm acting. And I think I'm fairly closed when I'm not acting.
Do you have a feeling that because you're in the public, it doesn't mean that the public has got to know all about you?
In a sense, yes. I can't see why people are interested in what colour my kitchen is or which way I brush my teeth in the morning or things like personal things about oneself. Mm. I think some performers, that is what they are selling, and there are other people who are selling something else, an interpretive, creative art, which is sounds very grand, but that's what I think I'm trying to do, and that can be done independently of people knowing what I do at home or where I live. Or
but just to clear it, what colour is your kitchen?
It's a rather ravishing combination of green and orange.
And how do you clean your teeth? Is it with an electric cleaner or is it...
Up and down.
Yeah.
Up and down.
And regularly? Always have since you were a child?
Of course. I haven't got many left.
Right. Now then, true or false about you that you cannot bear, I mean, to the point of almost feeling sick, seeing yourself on television?
Oh, absolutely true. My friends have now got used to me rushing from the room when suddenly something I did months ago will suddenly appear on the television in a trailer or something. I have to leave the room. I can't watch it. Some actors can learn from watching themselves on screen. I can't be subjective. I can only be totally objective. It's like people hearing themselves on a tape recorder for the first time and saying, God, is that really my voice? Do I sound like that? Well, I think, do I move like that? Do I look like that? I know what I was trying to do when I did that, but that's not what's happening. So I'm completely subjective about it, and I know that I can't change it. Whereas in the theatre, I can go on next night and try and be better. That's it on the screen, and there's nothing I can do about it. Mm. And particularly in films, when you've got to go on next day and do another scene, no, I can't learn. Yeah. I was playing Hamlet at Kronborg Castle in Denmark, and an American lady who'd been to see the show three times dropped a little note in my pigeonhole in the hotel. She was also staying in the hotel, and said, I would love to buy you a drink, you know, and I don't usually accept these invitations, but...
you sure?
It was a rainy afternoon, so I thought I'd go and have a drink with her, and we got on very well, and... I didn't realise, but at the time, she asked me that same question about working in America, and when I said, yes, I'd love to work on Broadway, it's an ambition. And it fell on fertile ground, this remark, and several months later, after we'd come back from tour, she was passing through London, she rang me, and she said, could we have a meal, and I have a proposition to make to you. So I went along and to the hotel, we had a meal, and the proposition was, would you like to do a play on Broadway?
How could she ask you that?
Well, she sort of virtually said, she was a very wealthy lady, and she virtually said, look, I and my company have got the money, we think you've got the ability, why don't we put the two together? She and her company, which was a Hollywood-based production company, mainly into films, wanted to break into the... Broadway scene in the legitimate theatre, not musical, but straight plays. And they thought that I would be good for them and they could be good for me. Mm. Then the next step was finding a property, finding a play. And within 2 months, The Suicide came along. I loved it and I knew it had been very well done and a great success with the RSC here in England. And it was going to be directed by... a man who'd left the Soviet Union in 1975, had been asked to leave, and the combination seemed too good to miss. I mean, everything seemed to be slotting into place. It was a fairy story come true, and so I ended up on Broadway. Mm. Every actor, I think, longs for one part that does it for him, mm. you know, and I think perhaps Claudius was that part for me. Mm. I hope it's not the only one. I mean, mm. I see it not as the end of a career, but as certainly a peak in... a career in, mm. in a mountain range. Strange you should mention Charles Laughton, because he was the one immediately thought of when I Claudius was ever mentioned, because he started to play it in a movie version in 1938, and the BBC showed me what was left of it in order to, in a way, lay the ghost of Laughton and do it, you know, for myself. In a way, I love playing unsympathetic parts, because I don't get to play very many of them. I seem to play a lot of victims and a lot of sympathetic roles. Diederik was a real bastard, and a bastard that won. I mean, he came out on top at the end. I think the only way you could take him at all was the fact that he was so outrageous and so awful. He was funny, and you could laugh at him.
But are you never scared of the man's own unpleasantness being put onto you, so to speak, that people dislike him, therefore dislike you?
No, I think people nowadays are more acquainted with the art of acting than perhaps they were in the past, because they see much more of it, and I think they know that we, the actors, aren't necessarily and do not behave necessarily as we behave and as we appear on the screen. Mm. I think they can separate the person from the character.
But, for instance, then, you did actually lose your temper very well, right?
Mm, I like shouting, you see.
But so yes, but have you, in real life, got a really bad temper?
No, I have no temperament at all. I mean, this is what's so bad about one aspect, I think, of me as an actor. I need more temperament. I wish I had more temperament. I try and galvanize what temperament I've got into my work, and when I'm in the theatre, particularly because that's my first love. Off stage, I'm rather placid and dull. I'm a true Libran in that I see both sides of the question. I'm fairly balanced. I'm very fastidious, but I never lose my temper. I walk away from rows. I walk away from arguments. I walk away from violence. I don't like anything that makes waves. That's why I like, in the theatre or on the screen, playing things that are totally opposite to my own personality.
When you said that actors, the acting profession chose you, you didn't choose it, what did you mean?
I think it's, well, it sounds a bit of a cliche. It's not meant to be, or a bit coy, but I think it's something I was born with. There was never a conscious decision to be an actor. There was never certainly any influence in my childhood, my early childhood, to persuade me to go into the theatre. I came from a totally untheatrical background. So I don't know where it came from, if it wasn't already there.
Hmm. Tell me about your childhood a bit then. You're an only child.
Yes, yes.
So got a lot of attention, did you?
Yes, but also a war baby. So Mum was out at work and Dad was in the army, so saw them occasionally. You know. So I got a fair amount of attention, but I don't think I got enough that spoiled me. I would like to have had brothers and sisters, up to a point. And then halfway through my teens, I thought, well, if I'd had brothers and sisters, I wouldn't have had all the pocket money, and I wouldn't have had all that I'm getting now, because it would have had to be shared, you see. That was a shallow period I went through. Now I would have quite liked them. But I had, fortunately, parents that I could confide in, whereas you would confide in a brother or sister, and I had parents who were that to me as well, so I was lucky.
When you said you wanted to be an actor, did they immediately think this is not the sort of job that we want for our only son?
Well, if they did, they didn't let on. Mm. They acted it very well. They gave me every encouragement. No obstacle was put in my way. It was suggested, and I acted upon it, that it would be a good idea to go to university and get a sort of higher education in case the acting went wrong, and that I couldn't actually earn my living at it. I could always teach history. I never believed that that would happen, that I would have to teach history, because I went to university with no ideas of being an academic. I went with an idea of acting all the time. And
was that because you were good at it at school then? Because you don't usually go to university with the idea that you're going to be an actor.
Yes,
you?
I well, not that I was good at it, but I was lucky at it. Mm. And so much of this profession is luck. I mean, you know, it's one of the most unemployed. The people in it are 80% unemployed or whatever, and we who do work are very lucky to be working. And my luck started when I was at school, when I did a production of Hamlet, which went to the Edinburgh Festival. And this was just before I went up to Cambridge. And it got a lot of sort of national attention in the newspapers by a fluke. And it was pure luck. And So when I went to Cambridge, I also knew that Cambridge was a hotbed of drama with a veneer of professionalism about it. And I was lucky enough to get a state scholarship. I was quite, I wasn't bright, no, I was a swot. And and I just swatted to get in, and I got in. And then I stopped all that, stopped that academic nonsense, and got on with the acting. And that's, the result of that is where I first met Bernard Hepton. Nothing can replace the buzz, the job satisfaction, the indefinable something that working in a theatre, doing a performance in front of a live audience can give you.
And yet every time you do a performance, you're nervous, because you told me so. Very, I mean...
Very,
so,
yes.
So why do you go through it, if it's such agony?
I think because it chose me. I have to do it. And the whole evening isn't terror. It begins with terror, but during the course of the evening, there can be wonderful moments. It doesn't always happen in every performance. You can't find inspiration every night of the week. I mean, once a fortnight is pushing it. But during the play, after a play, the exhilaration at the end of a play, if it's gone well, the fact that during a play you can feel when it's happening, you have that third eye that's standing halfway down the stalls looking back at you, saying, right, that's it, you're right, which is what timing's about, timing and rhythm. Goes back to rock and roll dancing. But I do think timing and rhythm are immensely important. And that is where you can practice them to their limit in the theatre. You can't in front of a screen because somebody else is pulling the strings. The director is pointing his camera at you or at me. I might be acting my socks off, but if the camera's on you, there's no point. Whereas in the theatre, they're seeing all of you all the time. And all this rhythm, all this timing is your own with the other people. On the screen, they're, particularly in the movies, when they can reshape the performance, can reshape the timing totally, can dub somebody else's voice onto you, that you are lending yourself for something else. It's a different technique.